The wood of these partitions, however, was so thin that it was possible to listen carefully to overhear at least the gist of any conversation that took place behind them. From the moment they had settled down and given their order, Penpetti's interest was aroused. In the very first sentence, he heard mention of his name, and fast on the heels of that, his own name in connection with the police. He listened intently, almost holding his breath, whilst Hansford quickly slashed his reputation to shreds in his peculiar telegraphic English. From mention of the missing crux ansata, he passed on to a detailed exposition of his belief that he, Penpetti, was the only possible person could have stolen it. It all sounded devilish clever and convincing, and there was no doubt that Hansford's reasoning was cutting a great deal of ice with Alicia. Penpetti's hackles rose. So Penelope was right, by heaven. Hansford was out to besmirch his good name in the eyes of the one woman he was most anxious to impress. Damn the man! It was intolerable, despicable. Somehow, by hook or by crook, he must put an end to this devilish slander. But how? Was Jacob the answer? Was it possible that Jacob's memory would prove to be more alert than his own? Was it possible that Jacob would recall just where he had met Hansford Bute before? Jacob was smart. He forgot nothing. If there was anything shady in Hansford's past record, then by God, Jacob was the man to know all about it. But the police, he thought. No, that's more serious. It was obvious that they had got the police onto the job of recovering the missing crux ansata, and that he himself was destined to be put through some sort of cross-examination. And at that moment, an interview with the police was something that struck Penpetti as peculiarly distasteful.